Okay, so thank you for waiting. So I am Arun Joseph. I am from Texas Instruments. So I am one of the maintainer for aerobot.org project. So this is an open source project where we are porting Android to some of the open source hardwares. Hope you heard about BeagleBot, BeagleBone, and BeagleBone Black. So such kind of open source hardwares. So we port Android for these devices, and we host these sources on aerobot.org. So I mainly work on porting Android. So, but in this presentation, I will be giving an overview of Android security, various attacks on Android, and what are the security blocks in Android. Then some guidelines for the people who work on Android. So I expect many of you are from Android development, and somebody who would like to extend Android framework for the different needs. So let us get started. So I'll be starting with some background on attacks on Android devices, and I'll be like telling what are the security building blocks of Android. So there are different layers, and the low level Android offers some features in the system and kernel level, and then in application security level, and Android is offering different there are different security aspects, and on top of above there are some Android cloud services which prevents Android malwares and some other attacks. So this is a graph which I took from a Trend Micro website. So they are a leading antivirus company, and they have some data till 2013 September. So they are showing that around 1 million Android malwares and high risk apps exist today targeting Android. So do you know how many apps exist in Google Play? So there are around 500 different app stores in internet other than Google Play. Some of them are dedicatedly like hosted for Android malware. So that is what these statistics indicate. And so mainly Android malware, like you can like classify the Android security threats into different categories. So, and one of the categories is Android malware. In that, we have like some of the malwares will be like stealing data from your phone, accessing your SMS contacts, email, etc. And then some of them will be doing online banking theft, fraud, and other things. And normally now corporates, big companies provide VPN access to your through your Android phone. So some of the malwares will be targeting that. So that will be from Android malware's perspective. So in general, when we talk about Android threats, there are other things. So there are something like insecure Wi-Fi networks that can act as a middleman kind of attack. So somebody sitting near you may not be like accessing their mails, might be like intercepting the whole Wi-Fi traffic and will be trying to get from the internet application layer. So that kind of attacks are there. That are network related attacks. So theft and losing of smartphones is also a security concern. So all your passwords, all your data are stored in your smartphone, and if a user loses this phone, there are there should be some way to lock that phone, or there should be some way to remotely locate that phone or wipe the data on that phone. So that is also an aspect of Android security. So then another thing will be routing. So normally, as an Android developer or a Android user, you would consider routing as a very good thing to have. But most of the device manufacturers would not consider routing as a good practice. Then that will be a security aspect from the device manufacturer front point of view, like a Samsung or a TA or Amazon point of view, that they would not recommend. Then network providers like AT&T, Verizon, such network providers would want their phone not to be unlocked so that they would lose the contract. So these are all security concerns from different people, different stakeholders of Android. And 2013 major highlight was master keys vulnerability, and this was discovered by one of the company called Blue Box, and they proved that 99% of the Android phones existing today can be attacked with this vulnerability. And even almost all apps, what this exactly is, update or install updated version of the legitimate application with malicious content inside that. So I'm not going inside that into the details. So I'll just quickly give an overview of what are the tactics used by these malwares. So mainly Android, I described the Android master key vulnerability, it was using repackaging of the application and inserting some malicious content, and would fool the user to install or to give his access. So that is one of the tactic. And the next thing is native code execution. So this is where most of the Android malwares are actually trying to get a root access in your phone so that they can access any area of memory. And then once they get the root access, they can do anything with the phone, data, or the network. Then Android 2.2 onwards, Android provides device administration APIs. They are just you can control your complete data, wipe your data, lock your phone with a password. So these device administration APIs are provided from Android 2.2 onwards, and users can be fooled to by the malwares to install as device administration applications, and they can get device administration privileges to wipe or lock the data. Then over the air attacks, in that Android would allow a network provider to push some settings on your phone, your APN settings. So there are many settings can be pushed onto your phone and fool the user that it is received from your network provider, but it will be doing something else on your phone. So a main goal of Android security is to limit all these attacks. And if the Android phone is affected, how to limit the impact? So this is the goal of Android security. And there are a lot of expectations from different people. You can consider Android users, Android application developers, Android device manufacturers, and the network providers. So some people would be generating content for smartphones, video or music. So all these stakeholders have different expectations from the Android security layers. So The challenge would be like you have your complete like almost 100% source open, and you have plenty of reference designs to play with. So there are like for a like attacker, there are a lot of like resources available, like the complete open source, and there are reference designs like Nexus 7, Nexus class of devices, and so these are the actual like challenges to provide the security while being open source and like with a lot of reference designs. How to like satisfy all the security needs from different stakeholders? So I'll quickly go through these slides because you know all these like the on the left side you can see Android platform building blocks, and the right side you can see the Android security building blocks. So I have just taken the differentiating factors of Android security. So if you can see from low level to high level, top level, you can see Android is actually like has enhanced the Linux security. And then it is providing a concept called Android application sandbox, and there are for Android framework and Android applications it gives a concept of permissions. Then at a Google Play level or cloud level, it offers different things called Android Bouncer, which is to scan like periodically like the Google Play content, and if any malware is detected, remove them. So that constitute the complete Android security. This is like the platform stack, the Android security stack. I'll just Android security broadly, like it is multi-layered, and this can be divided into three different layers. One is kernel system security at the low level, and in the middle level you can say application security, and top level Android cloud services. I'll go detail into different layers in the coming slides. So a quick overview of system and Linux security. So the main concept here we have is application sandbox. So we'll tell what is application sandbox. Then Android, if you like inspect an Android device, you would find different partitions like boot, system, data, cache. So many partitions are there, and the system partition is the one which contains almost all open operating system libraries and some core libraries. So this partition Android has made read-only. So then there is something called safe mode. If you enter into safe mode, only core applications of Android will be accessible. Then there are file system, regarding file system permissions. So each of the applications, whenever they create new files, okay, that files are applicable only to that particular application. Other applications cannot read the different applications file. Then Android complete Linux is enhanced with the security enhanced Linux project. So security enhanced Linux is something you can designate system resources. So even if you get a root access, you may not be able to access all the raw block devices. Let's say if you can actually label the raw block devices of your flash, and you can enforce some security so that the root, even getting root access, cannot destroy any data in some of the raw block devices. So I'll just talk about the main difference between the traditional Linux and Android. So in traditional Linux, we have different users, guest, some your name, so root, so many different users are there. So these are Linux kernel will give like complete security between the users of Linux operating system. But in Android, when it comes to Android, Android would be giving security between applications. When an application is executing, it is like protected from different applications. So this is achieved through Android, like Android thinks that each application is a user. So then and Linux kernel will enforce the security between users. So the resources are like protected from each other's each application. So this forms a basis for the application sandbox. So application sandbox is nothing but what I said, like there is no permission for an application to access the system data, the user's data, or any other application's data. And if you want to do if you want to access any other application's data, you have to declare permissions, and you have to like explicitly request through your Android manifest file. So one of the other aspect of your system and kernel security is memory protection. So most of the malwares would all these options Android enabled one by one, because many of the malwares in the past tried to attack these vulnerabilities. So maybe I can give you example of each memory protection where it was vulnerable at a earlier point of time. So mainly in memory attacks, the malwares would target the buffer overflows, mainly heap and stack overflows, and then integer and string overflows, then leaked kernel addresses. And the malware assumes that the code will in a executable image, the code area will be this, the data area will be this, the stack area will be this. So Android malwares would assume that. So to protect that, so there are features like address space randomization, where you cannot predict where the code area of an executable, where the data area of the executable. So all these options are enabled in the compiler level. You can find these options in the build directory or in the pre-built toolchain directory. You can find patches for these. So you know, right? Android toolchain, the toolchain is different from the normal ARM GCC toolchain. So from a user's perspective, you can actually encrypt your file system data, that is your data partition, which contains all your application data, and there is external storage that also you can encrypt. Then device password, it can be you can enforce the security complex rules for the device password. Then from Android 2.2 onwards, Android provides the device administration APIs, and enhance the VPN and the certificate storage, Android provides some more APIs in the later versions. So now we have covered the system and kernel level security. So now we are moving to the middle level, where we are classifying the system resources. In the Android app framework, you are classifying some APIs which are cost sensitive, and some APIs which are protected APIs. So you can find these APIs as examples. From applications, there is a permission check level. Under that, all the personal information and the sensitive input devices and the user data would come. So all these constitute the sensitive user data and the protected APIs. And from applications, there is a intermediate level where Android enforces the permissions. And the SIM card access APIs are a different thing. So for that, only you cannot access the SIM card by getting any of the permissions. You have to call it through the RIL layer, that is radio interface layer. So There is a like a, you like as an app developer, you will be aware of application signing process. You have to before installing to any device, you have to sign your application with a public key, private key pair. That is called certificate. And so Android uses this certificate. So I told that certificate is a pair of private key and public key, and Android uses this method to identify the author of the application, to identify the authenticity of your application updates, and if two application has to communicate each other, Android uses this certificate as a authenticity for communication between different applications from the same author. So this is so there are something called debug keys and the the normal keys. So you cannot sign an application with the debug key, then it cannot be uploaded to Google Play. So you have to create a private key public key pair. So you can use the key tool binary. It can be allocated in your SDK or in the Android sources in the host part tools. You can locate the key tool that can be used to create the key. And if this certificate is compromised, the other malwares can use it to update or give a repackaged version of your application with the malicious content. So also you can use the Eclipse tool where use the Eclipse tool to sign your application. So now we covered the one part of application security. So the one of the other building block is a permission model. So as I told, due to application sandbox, means each application is running as a different user in Android compared to Linux. So one application can access only its data. It cannot access the operating system's data, the user's data, or other applications' data. So if you want to access that data, so normally the application cannot read write other applications, keep the system awake or get the user data, etc. So if you want to do that, you have to explicitly mention it in your Android manifest file. And at the time of installation, the package manager of Android would ask ask the user to grant these permissions, and only at install time, and any other point of time. These permissions are granted only at install time, and it is granted forever. And you cannot request additional permission at runtime. And there is something called shared user IDs. So if you are an author of two applications, your two applications want to communicate each other without the need of permissions, you can declare a attribute called shared user ID by which you can access each other's file. Each other's application's file, and if you from your application, if you create a file with these flags, then it can become accessible by all the other applications. So in permissions, there are three concepts. One is using the permissions. Second thing is declaring the permissions, new permission, and enforcing the permission. So these are the main things in the permissions model. So as a normal application developer, you will be using the permissions. So to use the permissions, you have to use the attribute using permissions. And all the available permissions, you can find it in this link, or if you in your Android device, if you execute command pm list permissions, then it will list all the permissions. And if you go to your settings and you go to an application and at the bottom you can see what are all the permission one application would be like would be granted. And this is regarding declaring new permissions in your Android source code or in your Android application so that the other applications can use it. And this is how to you have to use the permission attribute to actually declare a permission. So now comes the permission enforcement. What we have covered is like using the permission and how to declare a new permission and how to enforce a new permission. Enforce a particular permission. So as an application, as a phone application or an SMS application, I can enforce the permissions onto my activities, onto my services, onto my content providers. If you are a mail application, you can enforce permissions onto your content. So that is called permission enforcement. So, and that you have to do in your Android manifest file, plus you can do at runtime also. At runtime, you can say that like if somebody is calling your service, if somebody is calling your content provider APIs, read content, write content, if somebody is calling an activity of your application, then you can check at runtime whether the calling process or the calling application or the calling process have that particular permission. Then there is something called URI permissions. So in URI permissions, the main thing is like consider a mail application where mail application doesn't have image viewer. So if the mail application has an attachment, so it would hand over that URI. URI is nothing but the path to a file to the image viewer application. The image viewer application should not access all mail content. So to prevent that, Android introduced a permission called a URI permission, where which you can like when a mail application pass an intent to the image viewer application, it can specify these flags so that it has the access. It is giving that content provider URI path to the image viewer only to that particular content. So and also content providers also should support this. So these are the 10 bad permissions described in Google I/O. So if your application has all these these permissions, then it is likely to be rejected in Google Play. So if your application is unnecessary asking these permissions, there is a good chance that the Google Play can reject your applications. So these are some guidelines. So instead of using the send SMS permission, you can ask the composer to be you can use the SMS composer, or instead of accessing the camera directly, you can use the image capture permission. So instead of reading the read font state, you can request for a random ID if a random ID only required for your application. So you don't need to access the font state or font identity. So there are 4 platform keys. So I told each application or each package has to be signed with a key. So there are 4 platform keys. So this is more of interest of a device manufacturer or an Android package, complete package provider, where you have to sign all of your platform and the shared and the media, all of your content with some keys. So there are keys provided in ASOP, but you have to generate your own platform keys so that it will pass the Android CTS. So you know Android CTS compatibility test suite is something suite which would validate your Android distribution. So starting from 4.2 onwards, Android gives support for multi-users. In multi-user scenario, we will just investigate what is the permissions and the applications. So I talked about user IDs. Each application is given a separate user ID. So in multi-user scenario, each of these applications will run with a different user ID for different user. So application code, so application package and the Dalvik cache and the application's native libraries all are shared, but the application's data and the application's runtime process is different for a different user. So Android would do it with appending or prepending the user ID with the application's original user ID. So Android updates, so if a security problem is reported to Google or Android, then they would intimate the OEMs and they will internally work on a patch and will deliver to the ASOP, plus they will deliver to the OEMs so that OEMs can give updates to the users. So there are some cloud services available, and the main one of them is Android Bouncer, which periodically checks all your Google Play content and removes the malwares. And there is something new called remote application removal. So remotely Android can remove malwares from your device. So this is a very recent concept which I just read in 1 month back. So I do not know the exact details of this. And Android provides application verifying, so you can select the verify apps so that your application can be verified while installing. And there is something new called Android Device Manager. So if you have latest version of Android, so if your device is registered for Android Device Manager from anywhere in the world, you can locate your device, you can ping, ring your device, you can lock your device, or you can wipe the data of the Android device. So Android also provides the backup and restore. So this backup and restoring will be a major security concern for the Android users. Okay. So this concludes my presentation. So the main thing which are being debated is the thing is a lot of Android devices are with older versions of the software, from Eclair onwards. So if a master key vulnerability is discovered and a patch is available from Google, the OEMs will not update the older devices, isn't it? So that is a discussion point. And the permissions, regarding permissions, the users will be granting the permissions at the install time only. You cannot modify the permissions. So that is also a discussion point. So anybody of you have any questions on these topics?
Hi.
Yeah.
Can you give an example of a simple attack?
Yeah.
Attack on apps.
Okay. I'll just give an example of from my perspective. So earlier Texas Instruments used to make Android SoCs which can run Android. In that, we have a graphics driver called our graphics driver was from Imagination. So that graphics driver exposed device node which is called DevPVRSVRKM, dev node. So the problem was any user application was able to open that device node and do some IOCTLs on that particular device node. Okay, so that device node, so internally the IOCTL was able to write to the kernel memory areas and which would give the root access. From root access, the malwares can proceed from there. So That was one of the attack, and the full description of the attack and the how to use that attack is described in one of the reference here. I have it in the reference page. And another good example is like in earlier versions of Android, there was one file called data. So this is one of the method I used to root my phone. So this attack is like you have a data local prop file earlier in Android system, so which was read writable for the user, normal user, where you can specify the read only property ro.secure equal to true or false. So you specify it as like a false, then on the next reboot you would get the instead of user prompt you will get the root prompt. So most of the category of attacks called Android boot kits were using this method, modifying the system property and reboot, and when you get the boot completed message you start your malware action. So there are like a lot of resources available which I have described in my references. You can go through that, you can find out different malwares, how they were able to get access to the Android root access. So mainly all these malwares were using the root access to the phone, mainly to their malware operations.
So I have one question. You have pointed out different security areas, but my question is, nowadays we bring our own devices to our offices. So we have on the same device we have organizations or corporate data as well as our personal data.
Yes.
So the email system. So
yeah.
We have the personal email as well as the corporate email. So how to segregate or is there any web services available for this particular area to secure the corporate data? Like we have encryption, we have like multi-user support nowadays, but anything else in this corporate and like bring your own device?
Yes, actually like from that aspect, Android provides the VPN APIs and the credentials APIs where you can like securely like store your like a company's certificates. So that is one area. And another thing regarding encryption and decryption. So you can like Android provides the OpenSSL and the Bouncy Castle APIs for encryption and decryption and for the network security and the other Java security. So that are like in OpenSSL even you can like accelerate your apart from the software implementation of hard cryptography, you can use the hardware implementation also. And in some cases, you can Android provides this layered approach, and anywhere you can tweak your security. So for that, like some examples, you can say Samsung Knox, where they have like expanded this security with the ARM TrustZone features. ARM TrustZone is a security feature. So thereby, you cannot run custom images onto your phone. So Android provides the device management APIs and the security framework consisting of the Bouncy Castle and the OpenSSL, and there are APIs to credentials and the VPN. And apart from that, Android provides the extensions also, extensible framework, so that the other vendors can extend the framework to suit their needs.
Hi, I'm Satish. You told us about application security. It provides the permissions while installing the app.
Yeah.
What if we have to update the app and it requires different permissions which are not malicious?
Sorry, if when you update your
The update needs different permissions. and the different permissions has to be granted. Will the security allow that?
Yeah, actually, like Android, like if you like check the Android guidelines, if it is a new permission being introduced by Android, okay, so you have to specify the target of your application in when you are building your applications. So Android would check that you mean the updating of the device or updating of your applications. So when you update your applications, Android would check what is the targeted SDK for that. And if you are like telling your target SDK is Android 4.4, okay, Android would check the requesting permissions with the available permissions. And like if the available permissions, like if you are requesting permissions has is correspond to the ones in the targeted device or the available in the targeted device, it would grant it. And normally your application, if your targeted SDK is Android 4.4, it would build with Android 4.4, but it cannot run on a lower SDK device, right? So the main distinction will come in your targeted SDK. So if your application is like targeted for Android 4.0, and if you are installing it on 4.4, where accessing some data was good enough in 4.0, and we would require a new permission in the 4.4 case. In that case, Android would think that your targeted SDK is 4.0, and this permission is only available in 4.4. So Android would think, okay, let's grant it automatically. So that is being mentioned in Android security guides. So that would I think that would answer your question. I'll be here afterwards also. You can
One last question, please.
Hi, I'm Raghavendra. You mentioned app will get a permission while installing, and it won't have any permissions after runtime.
Yeah.
So in this scenario, if app A is defining a permission, and app B is using the permission, if I install app B first, and then app A, then how it will?
Yeah, definitely Android would not indicate the user that the application has requested this API, but it didn't mention it in permission list. What would happen is a security exception will happen. Android will tell you that the application has been force closed. And if you look at the Android logs, you can see a security exception. So that is the way it would work. It would not indicate the user that this application requires an additional permission which was not listed when it was installing. So was that your question? So there are lot of security experts are questioning the way Android is assigning the permissions. But Android gives a very good explanation in their security guides to have the permissions in this way. When you install your applications, you request all the permissions forever. So that is mainly for the simplicity for the user. Okay, thank you.